Dad used to go to the gym, and it was something that he could sort of take us to play with him at the gym. We couldn't lift weights, obviously, we were small. I was 12, my brother was 10. My dad would be there. He had a racket, and eventually he found some rackets from a secondhand shop. And we went on court with him, so normal squash rackets are quite big. We had the very traditional ones with a really small head. Old school ones, and that's how we started playing squash. Within a year and a half, I started beating my dad. I guess the first time I really fell in love with it was going for a tournament where we had to go for trials, and I made the provincial team. And that's the first time I thought, okay, like, this is one of the sports I want to keep, because I felt like I had some sort of identity. I made the C team in that year for the first time that I went there. It was nice, because that's where I guess you build that sort of sense of identity, because you had this provincial jacket which you wore, which had the colors of your province, and it said squash underneath. If you wore that jacket, people knew what it was for. In hockey, obviously I played hockey, and it took a lot longer for me to develop that identity. But in terms of squash, there was definitely the jacket that you wore. When you went to a provincial tournament, you came with this fleece jacket which had the squash rackets which crossed, and you knew that he'd been to a provincial tournament. Sport and really getting passionate about it, but also how sport started to form part of my identity. With rugby, when I first started playing sport, the emotions and feelings that you get, I would say it's just been so long ago, but didn't feel anything like it was anything new, because as a boy, it's quite easy to run in your roughhouse, grab a ball, run away from someone, tackle them if you can. So there weren't really a lot of feelings. But with hockey, it was a lot different, because it was very technical. It's something that's not natural to you. You have to run in an awkward position. So I guess based on your preparedness, your skill and your level, you start to feel more confident. But a lot of it, especially in a game like squash, is more on you. It's more self-confidence of what you feel that you're going to, how you're going to perform. If you're fit enough, if you've practiced enough, if you've got all your, if you're feeling confident about certain type of shots. Whereas with hockey, it's a bit different. Squash is a individual sport. Hockey is a team sport. So squash is more of self-confidence and how you feel when you step on court. Whereas hockey is a lot different, because it's about how you feel about your teammates and how prepared they will be for you guys to go through this period of 60 minutes in a game. So, in terms of identities of squash, I played it at university. It got to a point where I wasn't enjoying squash, because it almost had a negative connotation to it. The way the setup was at the time, that if you're a squash player, there's certain, not things required of you, but there's just a certain way that you must do things for the team. I sort of disassociated myself with the game at that point and moved over to hockey. I did that for a few years while I was working. So yeah, I played obviously hockey, but at the back of my mind, squash was always going to be there. And even now, as I'm playing squash, hockey is always going to be there at the back of my mind. It was sort of by accident, in terms of trying to find new friends and adjust in a new city. I picked up squash again. I met a very good family, Dr. Pierre and Alberu and Rita and Frank Els, And through playing squash with them, I sort of started to enjoy it again, because it felt like, you know, what I was used to, which was just sharing time with people that you loved. I moved to PE, I was playing hockey and I was playing squash, but it was part of my identity, and it was such a big factor of who I was. Obviously, during the pandemic, when we couldn't do either of them, it became quite difficult to adjust, because so much of your time was spent on a court or on an Astro, and you were at a certain level of fitness, certain level of skill. That was part of your identity, and you couldn't get to practice that or keep that going or stay at that same level in terms of performance-wise. So if that's weight, how you move on the court or on the Astro, how you hit certain shots, how you pass the ball, like, you couldn't keep that up because you weren't allowed to play any sport. You weren't allowed to practice, you weren't allowed to be in those settings where you were sort of communicating and sharing information and, you know, learning and leveraging off each other. That obviously got stripped away from you, because you identify as that, but then by not being able to practice and commit and continue to do that, it sort of gets stripped away from you in that sense, because when you try to go back onto the squash court, you're not at where you were. You can't hit the shots that you were hitting. You can't run as long as you were running. Your movement is off because you haven't been practicing this for such a long period of time. You know what you can do. You know what you were doing. And when you go back there and look at yourself now, you're not in shape. You know, you're off form. You can't hit the ball the same way that you did. You can't run the same way that you did. And that sort of has the negative side of it, because I had associated myself so much with the sports that I play, but now I cannot do that anymore because I cannot play them the way I know I can. I don't know, it tears down, I think, your self-confidence, as I said. Part of that identity, part of that thing that you can always leverage off when you have a bad day, or, you know, if someone has to say something about you, you know, you can always lean on that to be, well, at least I know there's a community and society that knows that I'm a good squash player, and I can contribute to it with either helping people, motivating people, or just sort of playing with them. But now that I can't do that, you know, I don't know where it puts me in that space. Am I still valuable in that setting? And if I'm not valuable in that setting, and if I can't do what I was doing beforehand, do I lose that support? Do I lose that respect? Do I lose that place that I was at, where I felt confident in myself, at least if I walk onto a squash court, that I can handle myself. If I walk onto Astro, I can handle myself. And now that that's been taken away, you don't even have that to lean on. Trying to fill the gaps are a lot harder when you're a lot older, because you have the memories. And also, when you're younger, it doesn't feel like you're building up onto something. You know, it just so happens that you've built this 14 or 15 years of skill, and it was fun at the time, but then now you realize how important it is to you. So trying to find other things like running, I wouldn't say it doesn't feel as good, but, you know, you don't have the same confidence as you did have, or 15 years of playing squash, or, you know, 10 years of playing hockey. You know, it just doesn't feel as good as it would be if you were putting that same amount of time into, let's say, playing squash or hockey. It's finding new benchmarks versus the old ones that you know already exist. And that's difficult. I found myself obviously trying different things inside the house, looking at obviously bodyweight exercises, calisthenics. I tried obviously a lot more blogging, which is something that I did find was nice. But it is something that eats at you, because even then, when you see old friends and you move back to a place like PE, you know, you've mixed with the societies of squash and the circles within hockey, that when they see you, the first thing that they want to know is, when are you coming back? But I would love to come back, but at the same time, I'm stopping myself from doing it because I know that I'm nowhere near where I was. It's also protecting myself, because I'm just like, well, yeah, I guess it's insecurity at the end of the day to say, well, if you want to see them on the court, I don't want you to have that image of what you remember of me and then see me now and be like, oh, well, that's not the same person anymore. So the tough part about now trying to build a new identity is, I guess, the patience part. And not only patience, it's just actually finding a true, tested and proven framework. So the nice thing about hockey and squash is when I got into it is that I didn't have to decide what I was doing. I had a coach. A coach which would tell me what I'm doing. He would make me do the hard graft or the hard yards on the Astro or on the squash court. Make me do my fitness. Make me repeat my drills until I got them perfect. Whereas now, I'm pushing myself. Early on, I was put into a pool of people that could be potentially hockey players, potentially squash players, and you know, through grooming and through the process, you know, you go through the whole process of being picked and then groomed into certain positions or certain type of players. And that's what coaches help with, and that's what coaches helped me with, and that's how I became a squash player. It is through the help of Mr. Gilbert, Daryl Schwartz, Mr. Wood, Liz McKenzie, Carl Schwartz even as a person who played with me, that helped me become a hockey player. It is through coaches like Mrs. Thomas, Mr. Gilfillan, Mr. Larter, Gary from the time I played KZN Men's hockey, that helped me become the player that I was. And now it's a lot harder because there's no one looking after that. There is no one coaching me and directing me. So it's sort of on your shoulders and you've got a full-time job. And as I said, it's easier when someone is obviously steering the ship, but then if you have to steer the ship for many things and you know, you also lost your identity, you learn confidence, you the one which has to tell yourself to, you know, cheer up or to look on the bright side or restructure your program and plan, and that's difficult. I've tried to, but that's what I'm saying, that in terms, I've never been at a point where I haven't played for so long. I've never come to a point where I haven't played. Like, yes, obviously there was a time where I voluntarily gave up squash, but how I got back into it was obviously through coaching youngsters. And through that, fell in love with the game again to the point where I was like, well, these are the basics that I needed, but it wasn't for me, it was for someone else. And me stepping into the role as a coach to be like, well, this is what I would have wished, or this is what I wish I could have been taught. And these are certain things that I see in myself and these kids, and let me help them obviously get better so that they can obviously hopefully be better than I was. It was the same thing with hockey. As much as, yes, I enjoyed playing hockey on the social aspect, one of the biggest things that I did after a year of moving to Richards Bay was start a hockey club with my friend Clark, and we wanted to do it for the youngsters, you know, to sort of say, well, you know, I'm not going to teach you from a textbook, I'm actually going to show you and I'm actually going to play with you. The way it's happening now, where I'm just looking after myself, or I guess I don't have a coach, it's a lot harder because no one's looking out for the things that I'm not seeing. I can bullshit myself. I can say, okay, fine, you're going to go do, you know, 100 court sprints and then get to 50 and realize, okay, you know what, it's better than doing nothing. Let me stop now. So that's the difficult part at the end of the day is, I guess, not having the right framework, the right sort of guidelines to say, well, this is how you actually structure it to get back to where you were. On the gym routine, obviously, to be honest. I think that's a difficult part. There's just so many questions I have in my mind. I think there's also a lot of confidence and momentum and routine that you lose when something just stops for, you know, more than a year. And with the world being just very shaky in terms of when things will open, when things will close, you know, I could feel like it's great to make this plan and the next thing, you know, everything closes up again and then I lose momentum again and, you know, get through the whole spiral of doubting myself and my plans and regretting what I've spent in terms of time and money to try move on this path. I think the first thing is to probably try to find the right guidance or framework, or at least say wherever I'm at now, at least it's someone else's, you know, dream to be as a squash player, and maybe help them get to where I am now, and hopefully through that I design my own way to, or find out my own mentor or role model to be like, well, I need to work towards being that. Maybe that's how it starts, taking someone as a mentee. Coaching someone, and as they get better, that inspires me to get better for myself.